Hello and welcome students. We are into the 25th video lecture of the video lecture series made on the subject of machine design, whose subject code is ME303. And the topic which we are going to discuss today is the type of bearing. Basically, today I am going to start a new unit, which is the design of bearing. And in the design of bearing, the first is to understand what is bearing, what are the functions of bearing, then applications of bearing, and the different types of bearing. So today's video lecture is focused on these all areas of bearing, their functions, their types, and their applications. I am Shri Krishna Mishra, assistant professor in the Department of Mechanical Engineering, Suresh Gyan Vihar University, Jaipur. So before moving into the lecture, let's explore the objectives of today's lecture. The objectives of today's lecture. The objectives of today's lecture are, we are going to understand about what is bearing. Our main motive is, first, basically, we will know, we will understand that what is bearing, what is the function of bearing, what are the classification of bearing. All right. The first objective is to understand about what are bearings. And after, the second objective is to know about the classification of bearing. We will classify the bearings, as you would have seen bearing in your bearing. You would have all very frequently would have seen the bearings. So there are many types of bearings. So we will classify those bearings. And after, the third is to understand the anti-friction bearing. The third is to understand the anti-friction bearing. So what are anti-friction bearings? We will see. Then there are bearings which are known as journal bearings. All right. So our next motive, our next objective is to understand about the journal bearings. Then the next objective is, we will understand what are the requirements of a good bearing. Since we are studying about the design of bearing, so in design of bearing, at least we should know at the start that what are the requirements of a good bearing. What are the requirements of a good bearing? Then only we can choose the material for the manufacturing of bearing. Then we are going to at last design the journal bearing and anti-friction bearing. We are going to design the journal bearing and anti-friction bearing. So these are the objectives, students. We are going to understand what is bearing, then classification of bearing, then anti-friction bearing, then journal bearing, then what are the requirements of a good bearing, and then we are going to at last design the journal bearing and the anti-friction bearing. So stay with me in this lecture. Bearing, students, let's first of all start with an introduction. A bearing is a machine element which supports another moving element, which is known as a journal. Basically, bearing, what is the purpose of bearing? Bearing, though it has got many purposes, but in short, by a definition, we can say it is a machine element. Machine element means an element which is used in the machine. It is a part of a machine which supports another moving element. If there is a moving element in a machine, for example, if there is a rotating machine, rotary machine, for example, like fan, like your turbines, all these are rotating machines. So in these machines, definitely you will have to keep a bearing in order to support these moving machine members. Not only support, the main purpose is the support, for giving the support to the machine, rotating machine element, but it has got other purposes also. And the moving machine element, which is supported by this bearing, that part of the moving machine element that is supported by the bearing, that part is known as, the students, the journal. That part of the machine which is supported by the bearing, that is known as the journal. Basically, what is the plus point? For example, if this is your shaft, all right, and it is inserted, and it is inserted in a bearing like this. If it is inserted in a bearing like this, this is the side view, students. In front view, it will look like this. If this is the bearing and it is housing a shaft in it. it is housing a shaft in it in this way. All right, so basically the main function of this bearing is to support, to provide the support to the shaft. Shaft is what? Shaft is a moving machine member. So we can say in broad sense that it is used to support the moving machine element. All right, then after the plus point is that it provides the relative motion between the contact surface. If you are providing support to a moving machine element, student, it is very obvious that it will have to allow the relative motion between them. It will have to allow the relative motion, because since they are both are in contact, since the shaft or the moving member, rotating machine element, the shaft and the bearing, since they are in contact with each other, so it is quite possible that relative motion between them is will be hampered. So the bearing should be designed in such a way that it permits the relative motion between the contact surface of the members which are carrying the load, which are carrying the load. Now the third point is that if the rubbing surface are in direct contact, there will be a rapid wear. We all know that if these two surfaces which I have drawn here, one is the bearing and the one which is supporting the bearing, that is the shaft, if these two are in direct contact, then there will be rapid wear. There will be rapid wear of the shaft of the bearing. In order to reduce the frictional resistance, in order to reduce this resistance between the shaft and the bearing, and in order to reduce the wear, and in order to even carry out the heat generated, since there will be friction between the bearing and the shaft, so there will be friction, so there will be heat also generated. Due to friction, we all know that heat is also generated. So in order to dissipate this heat, all these three functions, one is the rapid wear, in order to prevent the rapid wear. Second, in order to reduce the frictional resistance, and third, in order to remove the heat generated from this frictional resistance. In order to serve these three purposes, a layer of lubricant is provided, a layer of fluid is provided, which is known as lubricant, between the shaft and the bearing. A layer of fluid is provided, students, which is known as lubricant, lubricant between this shaft and bearing. A layer of fluid is provided. I am drawing with this with a green color. All right, this particular portion between the shaft and the bearing, that is provided with a fluid which is known as lubricant, and its purpose is first to reduce the rapid wear of the bearings and shaft, the frictional resistance, that is to reduce the wear, and third is to remove the heat that is generated by this frictional resistance. All right, and this layer is of fluid, and it is known as lubricant. Now the lubricant used to separate the journal and a bearing is usually a mineral oil. Now what is the lubricant which is used for this purpose? The lubricant which is used for this purpose, which separates the journal from the bearing, journal means that portion of the shaft which is inside the bearing. All right, so in order to separate the journal and bearing, generally the mineral oil is used. Generally, mineral oil is used, that is prepared by refining the petroleum. All right, but sometimes vegetable oils, silicone oils, greases are also used for the lubrication purposes. It depends on the situation or a location where the bearing and the journal has been used. So this was the introduction in which we have understood about the bearing of what is bearing, what is the purpose of the bearing, and what where it is used, and between bearing and the shaft, that particular layer of the fluid, what is the particular, that particular layer of the fluid, what is the purpose of that layer of the fluid. Moving further, now the function of the bearing can be listed out in the following manner. These are the functions of the bearing. What are the functions? Let's list them out. First major function of the bearing is to give the support. All right, means it will aid in transmitting the power from one end of the line to the other. It is providing the support to the rotating shaft, means it is also aiding in transmitting power from one end of the line to the other. All right, so first is it helps in transmitting, it aids in transmitting the power. Second, it is that it needs a good support to ensure stability and frictionless rotation. to ensure stability and frictionless rotation. The support for the shaft is known as bearing. So that same thing which I have told to you, that the bearing is basically providing the support in order to provide stability and enable the frictionless rotation. Why this good support is needed? Good support which is provided by bearing, it is needed in order to provide stability, in order to provide stability and frictionless rotation to the bearing. Then the shaft has a running fit in the bearing. All bearings are provided some lubrication arrangement to reduce friction between shaft and bearing. As I have already told you that always there is a running fit. Running fit means always this bearing is fitted when the shaft is in motion, means always the shaft is in rotating motion with respect to bearing. So therefore, in order to reduce the friction, we always use the lubricant. We always use the lubricant between the shaft and the bearing. Moving further, student, these are the functions of the bearing. Now, two important categories, two main categories of bearings are, first is the plane or the sliding contact bearing, which is also known as the slider bearing. First is the plane or the slider bearing, which is also known as the sliding contact bearing. This particular bearing is also known as sliding contact bearing. Sliding contact bearing. All right. And the another one is your rolling contact bearing. Rolling contact bearing is generally seen, we have seen frequently, because generally in many application where the load that is acting on the bearing, if it is less, then in that cases we use roller bearings. There are many advantages of roller bearings. If the load which will be acting on the bearing, if that load is less, then in that case we can use the roller bearing, because roller bearings are anti-friction bearings. Very less amount of friction is generated between the shaft and the bearing in the case of roller bearings. All right. So in broad sense, we can say that the bearings can be classified into plane bearing or the sliding contact bearing. And in second is the rolling bearing or the anti-friction bearings. This is basically the diagram of the roller bearing. Here you see there are balls. There is a retainer which retains this ball. There is an inner race. There is an inner race, students. And there is an outer race. All right. So these bearing basically provides zero friction between the shaft and the bearing. So this is its plus point, but the negative point is that it can't withstand heavy loads. For heavy loads, students, what we use? For heavy load, you use this sliding contact bearing or the plane bearing, we say. Here, basically, these are the bearings in which the rotating shaft has a sliding contact between the bearing, which is held stationary. Basically, why the name has been given as slider bearing? Because here there is sliding contact between the bearing and the shaft. There is sliding contact, means the shaft slides on the bearing. The shaft slides on the bearing. And due to this, there is large contact area for friction. There will be large friction between the mating parts. All right. And therefore, it requires, if there is large area for friction, there is large area of contact between the bearing and the shaft. And due to this, there is high amount of friction that is generated. And due to this, there is greater lubrication that is required here. There is greater lubrication that is required. Large amount of lubrication is required in the case of slider bearing. Large amount of lubrication is required. Why? Because here the contact area is large, and due to this, the friction that is generated is also large. I mean, roller bearing, why I have to, these are known as anti-friction bearing. The reason is that, student, there is very less area of contact between the shaft and the bearing, and therefore the friction generated is also less. This, you need less lubrication or nil lubrication. You don't need any lubrication or you need less lubrication, and therefore they are written there, its name is written as anti-friction, no friction bearing. All right. So in broad sense, these are the two categories of the bearing. Now the bearings can also be classified into other types also. So what are those classifications? On the basis of different base, the bearings are classified into other types also. What are those classifications? See, these are the roller or the anti-friction bearings. This roller bearing or the ball bearing, you can either have a ball in between this inner race or outer race, or you can have a roller between inner race and outer race. In this diagram, you can see here these are the real images of the bearings. You can see here the balls are there between the inner race and the outer race of the ball bearing. And here you can see that for withstanding some moderate amount of load, this ball bearing can't withstand a high load. Even the moderate load is not withstand by these bearings. If you will apply moderate or heavy load in it, these bearings will fail. So in that case, in order to make this bearing withstand moderate amount of load, for that we use rollers in between the inner race and outer race. So these are the housing in which there is roller between the inner race and the outer race. These outer body is known as the housing of the bearing. This outer body is known as the housing of the bearing. Now, one more classification is there. This classification is based on what type of load the bearing is supporting. Means it is this classification is based on the direction of the load. This classification is based on the direction of load in which the load has to be supported. All right, so if we take this as a classification base, if we take the base of the classification as the direction of load that is to be supported, if this is the base for the classification, then the two types of bearing are the radial bearing and the second is the thrust bearing. On the basis of the direction of load, on the basis of the direction of the load, the two types of bearings are the radial bearing and the thrust bearing. What are radial bearings? Radial bearings bear the radial loads. As the name itself suggests, in radial bearings, the load acts perpendicular to the direction of motion of the moving element. The load acts perpendicular to the direction of motion of the moving element. All right, and in thrust bearing, in case of radial bearings, always the load is applied in the radial direction. If this is your shaft which has to be supported, if this is the shaft which has to be supported, all right, and if you need a bearing which supports the load in the vertical direction, if you need a bearing which supports the load in the radial direction, means in this direction, means along the radius. One is, this is along the radius direction, this is along the radial direction. All right, and if the load has to be supported in the axial direction, means if the situation is like this, that load which you have to support is in this direction. This is the case, student, when you use the footstep bearing or the thrust bearing. So in the case of thrust bearing, always the load that is to be supported by the bearing is the axial load. There can be two classification of the thrust bearing, students. One is the footstep bearing, which supports the bearing from the base. If a bearing supports the shaft from the base, I don't have the clear picture. It is in this way. If it supports the whole of the shaft or whole of the rotating member from the base, then it is known as footstep bearing. It has got whole of the arrangement. And if it supports by a, if it supports by a collar, if it supports by a collar somewhere like this, if it supports by making a collar in the shaft, then those type of bearings which support this axial load by making a collar, these are known as the thrust bearing. The main purpose of the thrust bearing is that it bears the thrust load which is acting on the shaft. Sometimes the rotating members are also subjected to thrust, like in the case of gears. As I have already told you in sometimes in your previous lectures, I have told you that these gears, the helical gears, they always provide thrust load. They always provide a thrust load. Thrust load means the load or the jerk along the axis. So in order to bear that type of load or the jerk, you should have a bearing which can support the axial load. So for that, we use the thrust bearing. So in short, we can say, students, those bearings which support the load, in which the load acts in the direction perpendicular to the direction of motion of the moving element, like this. In this diagram, you can see, in this diagram, you can see, students, that the load which is acting perpendicular to the direction of the moving element. All right. So in this case, the bearing is known as radial bearing. And what are thrust bearing? Thrust bearings are those in which are used when the load acts along the axis of rotation of the moving member. Like in this case, you can see here the load which is acting, it is acting along the axis of the rotating machine member. All right. So these are the bearings which you can see. Now, this is a thrust bearing actually, students. So now moving further, in order to explain you in a better way, this one more slide I have used here. You can see here easily, students, if your bearing supports the axial load, then it is known as your thrust bearing. And if the bearing supports the radial load, then it is known as the radial bearings. There are some bearings which support the axial load as well as the radial load. We will see later on in the discussion. Now, one more classification is there. This classification I have already told you, which is the sliding contact bearing and the rolling contact bearing. So rolling, one thing you should know, that a sliding contact bearing is also known as the plane bearings. All right, moving further. In rolling bearing, as I have told you, you can either use a ball or a roller between the moving and the fixed element. The ball, as you can see, the ball will offer rolling friction between the two points, and therefore this friction value is very less. These are the rollers which are used in the roller bearings. And in the case of balls, you use balls. In the case of balls, you use balls, small balls, metal balls. Now let's have a look on the different types of sliding contact bearings. Now there are various types of sliding contact bearings. Let's have a discussion on that. First, general sleeve bearings. One is this one, general or sleeve bearing. Second is the full general bearing. And the third is the half general bearing. We will see step by step. In first, let's look into the general or sleeve bearing. So what is general or sleeve bearing? When in the sliding action, when the sliding action is along the circumference of a circle or an arc of a circle and carries the radial load, then it is known as the general or sleeve bearing. So if there is a sliding action between the circumference of the circle or the arc of the circle and it carries the radial load, then we say that the bearing is known as your general bearing. As I've already told you, that portion of the shaft which is inside the bearing, that is known as the general. Therefore, it is known as general bearing or sleeve bearing, sleeve. The second thing is that when the area of contact of the bearing with the general is 360 degree, when the area of contact means the whole of the bearing is enclosing the shaft, if whole of the bearing is enclosing the shaft, then that type of bearing, that type of sleeve bearing or general bearing is known as your full general bearing. That type of bearing which supports the shaft from all the directions means it provides complete casing to the shaft. So that type of bearing are known as full general bearings. But there are many cases in which the bearing is not supporting the shaft from all the directions. All right. So first, this full general bearing, this type of full general bearing is commonly used in industrial machinery to accommodate bearing loads in radial directions. All right. Then after moving further, students, as I have already told you, when the angle of contact of the bearing with the general is 120 degree, not 360 degree, then it is known as not half, it is known as partial general bearing. That are known as partial general bearing. Partial general bearings are what? Partial general bearings are those bearings where you don't house the whole of the bearing. You don't cover the whole of the circumference of the bearing. You can cover only the 120 degree portion of the bearing. All right. So 120 degree portion of the shaft of the bearing. So that are known as partial general bearings. And what is the plus point with this type of bearing? This type of bearing has less friction, because area of contact has got is now less. All right, but it can only bear load in one direction. Means you can see here if the area of contact between the journal and the bearing, if it is less, you can see here, if it is less, then it is very obvious that you can support the load from one direction only, in the downward direction only. Then the third is the most common application of practical journal bearing is found in railroad car axles. In railroad car axles, you can find the application of partial journal bearings, because there we know that the load will be applied on the downward direction only. Then after the full and partial journal bearings may also be known as clearance bearings. These journal bearings, full or partial, they are known as clearance bearings. Why? Because the diameter of the journal is less than that of the bearing. Here the diameter of the journal, it is less than that of the bearing. Therefore, it is also known as the clearance bearing, because there is some gap between the shaft and the bearing. What is the reason for this gap? The reason for this gap is we can provide lubrication in this space between the journal and the bearing. Then after, when a partial journal bearing has no clearance, that is the diameter of the journal and bearing are equal, then the bearing is known as fitted bearing. Sometimes it happens that there is no gap, there is no clearance, there is no clearance between the shaft and the bearing. Then such type of bearing, such type of sliding contact bearing, such type of journal bearings are known as fitted bearings. They are known as fitted journal bearings. In these bearings, you don't have any clearance between the journal and the bearing. Both are of same diameters. Now, on based on the lubrication, also the shafts are classified. Based on the lubrications, the shafts are classified into thick film bearing and thin film bearing. So what are thick film bearings? See, sometimes in order to have high lubrication between the shaft and the bearing, there is a very thick film of lubricant which is used between the shaft. Generally, that thick film is provided by thick lubricants. The thick lubricants are your greases. Grease is one of the example of thick lubricant. Why? Because this thick lubrications, it aids in a manner that it doesn't allow the surface of the bearing to be in contact, to come in contact with that of shaft. The thick film lubrication helps in reducing the friction between the shaft and the bearing. How? By not allowing the surface of the bearing to come in contact with the surface of the shaft. All right, there is only one type of friction which is happening in this case of thick film bearing, and that type of friction is between the layers of the lubricant, because since lubricant is thick, so the only friction that is involved in the case of thick film bearing is the friction between the layers of the lubricant, like grease. Grease, if you consider different, that the grease is made of different layers, then there can be resistance between the layers of the lubricant, which we consider in viscosity. In fluid mechanics, you have read about the property viscosity, which is the resistance of a layer of a fluid on the other layer. So basically, that only is the resistance that is acting between the journal and the bearing in the case of thick film bearing. All right, thick film bearings are those in which the working surface are completely separated. This is an important word, completely separated from each other by the lubricant. Such type of bearings are also known as hydrodynamic bearings. Whereas thin film bearings are those in which, although lubricant is present, but there is always a partial contact between the working surfaces. There is always a partial contact between the working surface. All right, and at least for a period of time, there is always a partial contact between the working surfaces. Such type of bearings are also known as boundary lubricated bearings. Such type of thin film bearings are also known as boundary lubricated bearings. And thick film bearings were known as the hydrodynamic lubricated bearings. All right, so this was the classification of thick film and thin film bearings. Sometimes there is also a situation that there is no lubrication between the shaft or the general or the bearing, shaft and the bearing. So when there is no lubrication between the shaft and between the rotating member and the bearing, in that case, it is known as zero film bearings. Here, these type of bearings operate without any lubricant. All right. Then the fourth one based on the lubrication used is the hydrostatic or externally pressurized lubricated bearing. Now there are situations, students, these hydrostatic bearings, you should know that they are those bearings which can support steady loads without any relative motion between the journal and the bearings. These can support steady loads without any relative motion between the journal and the bearing. Basically, these are externally pressurized lubricated bearing. Means here we used to always put the lubrication between the rotating members through external pump, through external means. All right. So these are known as hydrostatic or externally pressurized lubricated bearings. So this is achieved by forcing externally pressurized lubricant between the members. Here we put externally pressurized lubricant between the rotating members in order to reduce the friction between them. Now, hydrodynamic lubricated bearings, coming into hydrodynamic lubricated bearings, students, in hydrodynamic lubricated bearings, there is a thick, as I have told you, there is a thick film of lubricant between the journal and the bearings. All right, and there are some assumptions which are taken in hydrodynamic bearing. What are those assumptions? First, your lubricant, whichever you are using, it is obeying the Newton's laws of viscous flow. As you all know, you would have studied in fluid mechanics, what is Newton's laws of viscous flow. The second assumption is that the pressure is assumed to be constant throughout the film thickness. While designing the hydrodynamic lubricated bearings, these assumptions are taken that pressure is constant throughout the film of the lubricant. Third, the lubricant is assumed to be incompressible. Fourth, the viscosity is assumed to be constant throughout the film. And fifth is that the flow is one-dimensional, that is, the side leakage is neglected. We are neglecting the side leakage of the lubricant in case of hydrodynamic bearing. All right. Now, students, these were your hydrodynamic lubricated bearings, bearings which relate with sliding contact bearings. Now, apart from that, I have already told you there are ball and roller bearings. The plus point with this are that these are also known as anti-friction bearings. These are also known as anti-friction bearings, students. The reason is that they provide very less friction between the supporting members, between the bearings, between the shaft and the bearing, there is very less friction. All right, so here the friction is considerably less than in plain bearings. Second, rotating or non-rotating parts are separated here by balls and rollers. Rotating and non-rotating parts are separated by balls and rollers. Third, balls or rollers have rolling contact or sliding friction. Sliding contact, balls or rollers have either rolling contact or sliding, only the rolling contact. All right, balls or rollers have the rolling contact, and due to this, the sliding friction is eliminated, and it is replaced with rolling friction. We all know that sliding friction is of larger amount as compared to friction. So by using balls and rollers, the sliding friction is eliminated and there is only rolling friction. Then often in plain bearings, the surface starting resistance is much higher. You all know due to increased area of contact between the two surfaces, in the case of plain bearings, there is always higher starting resistance. All right. So therefore, you need a lubrication in this. But in ball and roller bearing, the initial resistance to motion is only very much less. All right. And the third point, next point is that here ball and roller bearings are more suitable to drive subjected to frequent starting and stopping. Since you can see that starting resistance value in case of ball bearings or roller bearings is less, therefore they can be used in those machines in which the rotating member has to be frequently started or stopped. Then owing to this low starting torque, a low power motor can be also used for a line shaft running in ball bearings. Due to this plus point of this roller bearing, we can use a low power motor in case of ball bearings. All right. And we will go into classification of these ball bearings and later on in the coming lectures, students. This is the diagram of a bearing which is having ball or roller in it. So now the different types of roller bearing are: first is single row deep groove ball bearing. It incorporates a deep hardened raceway which makes them suitable for radial as well as axial loads in either the direction, and provided the radial loads are greater than axial loads. So this particular type of single row, this particular type of roller bearing basically is used in order to bear the radial as well as axial loads and in either directions. But one thing you should keep in mind, that the radial loads here are generally higher than the axial loads. So these are basically deep groove bearings, and here there is only a single row of ball bearing which is there. There is only a single row, so it can be used for light weight purposes. For bearing light weights, light loads, this can be used. So this is the first type of bearing, single row deep groove ball bearing. Then the second type of bearing is the single row roller bearing. In the case of single row deep groove ball bearing, the balls were used in single row deep groove ball bearings. All right. While in the case of single row roller bearings, the rollers were used in place of balls. In place of balls, in single row roller bearings, the rollers were used. Rollers means generally a series of rollers are used between the inner race and the outer race. And this particular thing provides the roller bearing a special quality. The roller bearing so can have greater load carrying capacity. The load carrying capacity of the single row roller bearing is higher as compared to deep groove ball bearing. All right. Or if they are both of equivalent size, as this roller bearing make line contact rather than point contact with their rings. In case of the ball bearings, there is point contact between the inner race and the outer race. So due to that, it can't sustain much load. While in the case of roller bearings, there is line contact between the two rollers. Between the two rollers, there is always a line contact. If these are the two rollers, there is always a line contact between them, and also between inner race and outer race, there is line contact. All right. Then apart from this, this is single row roller bearing. All right. Other benefit of single row roller bearing are that, one is that it can sustain greater load. It can sustain greater load. The other is that though it is suitable for greater load carrying capacity, but it is not suitable for axial loading, and it is cheaper to manufacture. This is again a second plus point, that it is cheaper to manufacture, and it is used for heavy and sudden loading. It is used for very heavy loading and also the sudden loading. Sudden loading are which are applied for at a very small instant, and these are very suitable for also those purposes where the shaft is running at very high speed and there is continuous service, and there is very continuous service. So whenever there is any continuous service and a large load has to be bared by the bearing, and also you don't need much friction, then in that case we use single row roller bearing in place of single row deep groove ball bearing. The only minus point is here is that it can only sustain the axial loading. So this was the plus point with a single row roller bearing. Then after moving further, students, as you can see, this is the diagram. You can see here in the diagram also, this is the diagram for ball and roller bearing. In this you can see there are balls inserted in the cage or at the retainer, we can see. This is the block diagram of ball bearing. We will go into the in-depth study of ball bearing later in the coming video lectures. You can see this top portion is known as, this is the sectional view of the ball bearing. This is the upper portion, outer ring. There is inner ring also. And in between, there is a cage. There is a cage in between in which the ball is kept, in which the ball is kept in this way. All right. So these are the ball bearings. All right. As you can see, then the races and balls are high carbon chrome steels. The races and balls are made of high carbon chrome steel. Why? To provide the resistance to wear. And they are machined and ground to fine limits of 0.0025 mm. They are highly polished and hardened. The cages are made of low carbon steel or the bronze or the brass. Though for high temperature applications, case hardened and stainless steels are used. For high temperature applications, case hardened and stainless steels are used for this ball bearing. Moving further, some other advantages of ball bearings. Let's have a list out of that. See, the inner ring or the race which fits on the shaft. Inner ring is the one which fits on the shaft. This is the inner ring, students. It fits into the shaft. Then after, the outer ring is what? Outer ring is the one which fits inside the housing. This is the student, the outer ring. The outermost ring is the one which is fits in the housing. It is known as outer race also. Inner race, outer race. Then ball and roller arranged between the two surfaces. These ball and rollers, which we use in case of ball bearing or roller bearing, here these balls and rollers are arranged between the two surfaces. Between these inner race and outer race, these balls and rollers are arranged. And they provide the rolling action between the races. They provide the rolling action between the spaces. The radius of track for the ball is slightly greater, 5 to 10% than the number of balls themselves. Generally, the radius of the track for the balls is 5 to 10% greater than balls themselves, so that there should be gap between them. Note that rotating surface rotate in opposite directions. You should keep it one thing in mind that the inner race and outer race, they rotate in opposite directions. One is stationary generally and the other rotates in opposite directions. The cage is the one which separates the ball or the roller from one another. It's the one which separates the ball or the roller from one another. All right. So this is the ball and the roller bearing. This is the brief description of the parts or the construction details of the ball or the roller bearing. You have inner race, you have outer race, you have a cage, and you have a retainer which retains the ball within their locations. Now coming into the disadvantage of this particular type of bearing. The disadvantage of this anti-friction bearing or roller or ball bearing, you can say, that these type of bearings are generally costly and they cannot be used in half and greater noise. They cannot be used in half noise or greater noise. So this is the particular description of ball and roller bearing. Through this diagram, you can understand in a better way. This is the complete diagram. This we have taken out the outer race from the other arrangement, and then here this is not the ball bearing, this is the roller bearing, because you can see there are rollers which are kept in the cage, or the retainer, and this inside one which fits into the shaft is known as the inner race. So inner race, outer race, and the cage, these are the three important parts. Now let's discuss some multiple choice question, students, in order to assess whether we have understood today's lecture or not. So first, let's see what is the first multiple choice question. The first multiple choice question says that which of the following are functions of bearing? Ensure free rotation of shaft with minimum friction, holding the shaft in correct position, transmitting the force of the shaft to the frame, or all of the above. So we all know that it ensures minimum friction, it holds the shaft, it transmits the force of the shaft to the frame. So all the three options A, B, C are correct. So this means that the D, which is saying that all the above three are correct, is the correct option. D is the student's correct option. This was our MCQ number one. Now moving into the next multiple choice question, question number two. What is the question saying? Let's see. A radial bearing supports the load that acts along the axis of the shaft. Whether it is true or false, a radial bearing, this is wrong because a radial bearing supports the radial load, not the axial load. And here it is saying that radial bearing supports the axial load. This means that this statement is wrong, means option B is the correct option. Coming into the next multiple choice question, students. Question number 3. A dash bearing supports the load along the axis of the shaft. Now, along the axis of the shaft, the bearing which supports the load is basically which type of bearing? The load, the bearing which supports the axial loads are known as the thrust bearing. So, option 1 itself is giving you the correct answer. Option A is the correct answer, that a thrust bearing is the one which supports the load which acts along the axis of the shaft. Option A is the correct option. Then coming into the question number 4, what is the question saying? Let's read out. Sliding contact bearing, also called plane bearings, have no problem of wear. Whether this statement is true or false? This is false statements, because the main problem in case of sliding contact bearing is that they have a problem of wear, and therefore we have to provide the lubrication between the two surfaces which are in contact, between the shaft and the rotating member. We always have to put some lubrication, because there is high friction involved in the case of sliding contact bearing. So this statement is false, and therefore option B is the correct option. Coming into the multiple choice question number 5. What is the question saying to you? Let's read out. In steam and gas turbines, the rolling contact bearings are used. Whether this statement is correct or not. So this statement is again a false statement. Why? Because in steam and gas turbines, you don't use the roller bearing. In that cases, you generally use the sliding contact bearings. Then after the question number 6, what is the question number 6 saying to you? The question is saying, which of the following are true about plasticity? Plasticity, we all know that it is permanent deformation. A is correct. Then B, ability to retain deformation under load. This is also correct for plasticity. Then C, plastic deformation is greater than elastic deformation. This is also true. So we can say all the three statements are true. This means D is the correct answer. D is the correct answer. So this was the multiple choice question number 3. Coming into the next multiple choice question, which of the following is measure of stiffness? So among these properties, the first one, A is your modulus of elasticity, B is your modulus of plasticity, C is your resilience, and fourth, D is the toughness. This is our MCQ number 7. So what should be the measure of stiffness? We all know, students, that modulus of elasticity is itself the measure of stiffness. Modulus of elasticity, the area under the stress strain curve till the elastic limit, gives you the measurement of measure of stiffness. So this means that modulus of elasticity is the measure of stiffness. All right. Why? Because stiffness is the property of a material to resist deformation under external load. Hence, it is measured by modulus of elasticity. Coming into the multiple choice question number 8. The question is saying that which of the following facts are true for resilience? See, option A is ability of material to absorb energy when deformed elasticically. This is the correct statement, but we will have to see whether what the other statements are saying. Ability to retain, second is ability to retain deformation under the application of load or after removal of load. This is not resilience. Then as heck, third is ability of material to absorb energy when deformed plastically. So you can see option A is only the correct option. Option A is the correct option. This means that A is correct. This was our MCQ number 8. Coming into the next multiple choice question, MCQ number 9, the modulus of resilience is defined as, we all know, it is related with energy, strain energy per unit volume will give you the value of modulus of resilience. Strain energy upon volume will give you the value of modulus of resilience. Then question number 10, what is the MCQ number 10 saying to you? MCQ number 10 is saying, this is our MCQ number 10, It is saying that in gearboxes and small size motors, rolling contact bearings are used. So in motors and in gearboxes, we generally use the rolling contact bearings. This is the correct statement. So A is the correct. All the multiple choice questions we have discussed, students. Now for your personal study, for your self study, you can use any of the references given in the screen. Even I have used the references book while compiling the video lecture, for compiling the content study material for the video lectures. I have used these books as the references. So for today's student, that is enough. Thank you. Thank you and have a nice day.